Hi, everybody. Welcome. I'm Anne-Marie Slaughter. I'm the president and CEO of New America. And I have to tell you, I was thinking earlier today, this is why I left Princeton University for New America, because there is nothing I could have done in my job as a professor at Princeton that would have allowed me to introduce Cat Cora. So I'm thrilled to welcome you to tonight's event hosted by New America's Breadwinning and Caregiving Program on the Homemaker Mystique. So we all know about balancing work and home, and not only our work pressures, but increasingly the pressures to bake from scratch or cook organic. I can't say that this is something my kids are familiar with, but I am aware of the pressure. Sort of this increasing emphasis on healthy eating, healthy living as a mom or as a parent, with, of course, the balance of work. So tonight we're going to be hearing from someone who has mastered both without any question. I'm thrilled to introduce Kat Cora. She is a wife, a mother, a business owner, and an entrepreneur, and of course, a chef. She's the first and only woman Iron Chef. She's been awarded Bon Appetit magazine's Teacher of the Year Award. She has restaurants in New York, San Francisco, Houston, Walt Disney World, and Singapore. She runs an app, a web series named Muppet's Kitchen, and a cookware line. So Kat Cora is also known for her philanthropy. She is the president and founder of Chefs for Humanity, which is an organization modeled on Doctors Without Borders, which gathers the culinary community together to provide resources and raise funds in critical emergencies, and also for educational and hunger-related causes. She has been appointed by UNICEF as a nutritional spokeswoman. She's joined First Lady Michelle Obama in her Chef's Move to Schools program. And she's currently working on adopting an elementary school near her home in Santa Barbara. Most recently, she traveled to Ethiopia in February 2012 with Save the Children to help shed light on the global child hunger crisis. Before I hand things over to Kat, who will, and then we'll move to our panel after she speaks, I just want to thank a few people. First, our event underwriter, Betty Crocker, who partnered with us on this event, celebrating the modern American home. Thanks for making this possible. We want to continue that partnership. And I'd also like to thank NPR for hosting us in this gorgeous space. And finally, of course, to our New America staff who've made this possible. So with that, I welcome Kat Cora.
Hi. Good evening. Good evening, everyone. Thank you to the New America Foundation for having me here tonight. You know, this is, I'm excited to be on this panel. I think it's going to be really a really great conversation about, you know, families, the new American family today, the modern family, if you will. It got me thinking about a lot of things that I would speak about tonight, but you know, first one of them is really about the first time, you know, and talking about the family in general, and then I'm going to get into some meal time and the way that our family, you know, balances, if you will, as much as we can, balances our day-to-day life as also a modern family. And you know, one, it got me thinking about the first time my kids ever asked about having two moms. You know, or their friends asked about having two moms. And, you know, the way that we explained it was, is that, you know, families, there's very different families. You know, there's some families that have two moms, some have a mom and dad, some have two dads, some have, you know, families where the grandparents are taking care of them. Some are blended families. You know, we have a divorce rate and some second marriages where they're bringing families together. Some are, you know, single parent homes. So I said, there's lots of different, you know, this new modern family represents a lot of different people and a lot of different structures and how families are structured. But it also got me to, you know, talking about with them how they were conceived, which you should have seen their faces, obviously. when we started talking about laboratories and petri dishes and IVF and things like that, because we were having just the other night a conversation about the birds and the bees. We have, my wife and I have four boys, 11, 7, and 2 5-year-olds, and they were all curious about it. And brought, we had a book that they wanted to know about all of the body parts and when they were going to get hair under their arms and how babies are born and how are babies made. And it was lots of questions from four boys. And so we started explaining to them how they were conceived. And so it really, it does, it really brings a good discussion today. It really opens up a conversation, which I think is going to be fantastic with the panel, is about the new American family. You know, when I was growing up, my parents, I came from a, my parents were together for 50 years. They were married for 50 years. My mom was a very strong woman. She was an incredible example to me. She had her doctorate in nursing. She, came to Washington many times to Capitol Hill to talk about nursing rights and funding and lobbying for this and lobbying for that, for nurses. She wrote journals. She created grants. I mean, she's a really brilliant woman, still is today. And my dad was a school teacher, a public school teacher for 35 years. So in the sense, my parents were two strong parents, my mom being a very strong woman, but and my dad being somewhat pretty hands-on for the 70s and 80s, I will say. But once, literally, 5 o'clock, my mom got home, my dad would, you know, really, and to his defense, I mean, this was kind of the status quo. He'd grab a cup of coffee, reheat some coffee, grab the paper, go sit in the recliner, and my mom would put dinner on the table, help us with homework, bathe us, you know, and run the household from then on. And so, you know, this really, this discussion as well, and this thinking about this is like, wow, even though my parents were super, my mom was a really strong woman, still is, they had very traditional roles. It was a lot like I Love Lucy, Ozzie and Harriet, Leave It to Beaver, and that has just changed completely. One reason is because our lives are faster than it's ever been with the technology age. Roles are changing because a lot of families are two income, and they had to. They had to develop and really evolve from those days where one parent could kind of, you know, help, be the authority figure, go to work, be the breadwinner, and come home. And, you know, that's those days of coming home, pouring a drink, sitting in the recliner, reading the paper are over. I mean, granted, there are days that sounds really good to me as the breadwinner, but, you know, that's just not how our lives run every day. And, you know, really it's, we've also become more aware, I think, as a society, that, you know, it's really beneficial to the kids and to a family as a whole when both parents are really involved in nurturing and raising the children and being present. But it's just a very, it's a very different world today. I know for myself, I'm the breadwinner in our family. My wife stays home with our kids, which would have been a title that would have been homemaker years ago. Bravo brought it back as housewives, God help us all. And then today we say in our family, it's, you know, my wife works inside the home. So we don't classify it as like, you're a housewife, I'm the breadwinner. We really say, I go out and work in the world, and you stay home and work in the home. And because it is the hardest job on the planet. It really is. I think the only second hardest job, or the really before that, would be being a single parent trying to do that, trying to do it all. Because, you know, that's really part of it. Really, we've got a lot of single parents out in the world that are trying to, you know, I know many that are struggling, sometimes have to work a couple of jobs, try to get home at 5, try to put dinner on the table. And that brings me to trying to put dinner on the table and our roles. And so, although I am the breadwinner and I go out in the world every day, I travel a lot, I've really been able to, you know, put my intention in a place where, since I have my own company, I don't have to travel 250 days a year the way I've been doing for the last 15 years. This year, I've kind of swapped that out a little bit, reversed it some, and stayed home more because I want to be home. But I'm lucky. Believe me, it's not lost on me and how lucky we are. But most Americans have to work each work. I mean, most Americans do have to have two working parents in the home. And to just make it these days, it's really tough to have one parent with all the pressure of either single-handedly taking care of the kids or single-handedly going out and earning the money. But, you know, the role is, you know, the roles for us in our house and the way we really run our household every day is that we do share in that role. I usually cook dinner, and there is a lot of pressure, I think we were talking about. There is a lot of pressure to cook from scratch or to bake cookies every day when the kids come home and to do these, you know, all these things that we saw in the sitcoms, if you will, you know, that we used to see and used to know that role was happening, you know, that the mom, you know, like in Leave It to Beaver, was there with the fresh baked cookies on a plate when the kids came home from school. And we just know that that's not reality today. We live in a really busy society. We live in a we want it now society where convenience is really important. And so for me, and the way that we run our household is that we get up in the morning and we have a normal day where we're really getting up with four boys, active boys. Jennifer and I are both, my wife, we're tag teaming on breakfast and lunch, packing lunches, trying to pack a healthy lunch like we all want to have for our kids, trying to make them a healthy breakfast that sustains them through the day or gets them at least two lunch, getting them dressed, getting backpacks packed, getting water bottles ready to go, making sure they have a snack for midday, being home when they get home. I usually cook dinner, although she's a great cook. I usually try to put something, again, even though I'm a chef and I know how to whip something up, it is a little easier for me to kind of go in the refrigerator and go, okay, I got some chicken here and I've got a little of this and I've got some veggies and I'm gonna throw this together. But for everyday people trying to put dinner on the table at 5 o'clock, I feel your pain because I have to do the same thing. Even as a chef, it still gets difficult to say, what am I gonna make today? How am I gonna make it healthy? How am I gonna make it nutritious for the family? And that's really our day. We're like every other family out in America, trying to just feed our kids, take care of our kids, nurture them, make sure that they're healthy and they're happy and they're well-rounded. And so, you know, at mealtime, we usually turn all the technology off. You know, that's kind of a rule in our house. And I think what I've discovered is being busy parents. One of the things that I've discovered over the years is really going back to the way my parents raised us. You know, kind of going, even though this is a new day and age, some of those old traditions are still really viable today. You know, mealtime, taking the phones, shutting the phones off, making sure TVs are off, all the technology's off, the kids don't have toys at the table, that it's just about us. It's just about having a conversation around mealtime. And to me, it's one of the most sacred times that we have together. I think it's one of the most sacred moments that all of us have time together because we have to eat. You know, everybody's got to eat dinner. And that's a really incredible time to really get in some good conversations with your kids, to ask about their day, even if it's 20 minutes and you're running a soccer practice or you've got this going on or you've got homework or what have you, is taking that time as much as possible. I don't know when this happened, when soccer games and baseball games started pouring over into our Sundays. You know, I know that there's days when we get up at 7 o'clock and 7:30 in the morning on a Sunday and we have to go to a soccer game. You know, those Sundays used to be sacred days where we knew that we were going to work all week long, but we got that day to, you know, you may or may not have gone to church. We went to church every Sunday. You know, we came home, we had brunch together, we'd go to the park, we'd go to the zoo. We did something as a family. And now that all that structure has changed as well, and that's shifted. And so bringing together, you know, the family over some time, the quality time, I think we're all probably struggling to do that, to try to carve out those times together as a family. And I think it doesn't matter the structure of your family. That's an ongoing battle to try to find that quality time, especially as kids get older, you have different ages. You're trying to, you know, create a situation where everyone is benefiting from it. Everybody wants to do it. I mean, that's one of the hardest parts, right, is when you have multiple kids and you've got a 12-year-old, a 7-year-old, a 5-year-old, and trying to figure out something that works for everybody, that everybody can be happy around. So I come back to mealtime because, again, that's a time when you know everyone's going to eat, everyone's gathered, and you have a chance to have a conversation and really, you know, discover what's happened during the day, talk to them about their day. I find cooking with my kids has helped me bring out conversations. I find when you're not looking, when your kids are not having to look you in the eye and tell you about your day, they'll tell you everything. You know, if you're driving down the street and you're taking them to a soccer practice, you're taking them to a school function, you're taking them somewhere, having a conversation where they're not looking you directly in the eye, they'll talk to you. Cooking with them, you know, doing some kind of activity together has always been really, you know, really beneficial to all of us and our family. You know, and we really work hard, I think, today as well, is blending many things, blending faiths together. And I know in our family, I'm Greek Orthodox. I come from Mississippi, from a Greek household. I know that's disturbing, but true. If you've never had feta cheese on biscuits or grits, you're missing out. So you should try it sometimes. But that's, you know, blending Greek Orthodox with the Jewish faith, blending ideas together, blending, aspirations for your children, blending aspirations for yourself together and working that out and creating a balance within your household and really carving out, again, connection between you and your spouse, connection between you and your spouse with the kids, and then the family as a whole. So I think that, you know, I can say that along with all of you, I know that we as well, you know, my wife and I have to get creative. And we have to find ways to do that and have to find ways to compromise in our lives. And some of it's great, you know, I mean, we come together and, you know, we have extracurricular activities. We've got a busy lifestyle. We've got kids in school. We're running from here to there. But I think it's really crucial that you do kind of carve out that time for yourselves and you carve out that time for that family time, because I think really that is what's going to create that balanced, happy family. You know, we've managed to do it. I mean, we've managed to have time to travel together. We've managed to have time to, again, my career, you know, is a little bit of an anomaly because I've been able to carve out those kind of time for myself. And because I am the CEO of my own company, I can, you know, I'm kind of the boss of me. So I can make my schedule. But I also have a huge pressure of providing for six people as a sole breadwinner. So it's a balancing act every single day to say, how can I carve out time to be home more? Because I think also the struggle with two moms is that we both want to be moms. You know, we both want to be there. We have, you know, I'll never forget Michelle Obama, one of the first lady said, one of the things I'll never forget her saying is that no matter what, as a mom, you're going to have mom guilt. Whether you work, whether you stay home, whether you work and stay home, no matter what, and you just have to, you have to come to peace with it. And you have to be able to find that balancing act that works for your family. And every family, it's not one size fits all. Every family is different. Every family has challenges. Ours being transitioning in and out because I traveled a lot. You know, it's that transition back into the home where my wife would say, well, I've set a whole routine up and now you're back. You know? And it's like, yeah, I live here. You know, so it's kind of that transitioning of in and out and travel, but we managed to make it work. Yes, throw in some couples therapy. It always helps. Having a strong mantra between you as a couple. Ours is that we always know, we always say that no one's going out of this relationship unless you're horizontal, meaning there's no option. So it's really about creating that strong bond. Yeah, that's really, it is. It's like you're not going out of this marriage unless you're horizontal. So just live with it. You're here. We're committed. And I think that those kinds, all of those things as a whole have created somewhat of a balance. We work, it's a work in progress every day. I think one of the best things that's come out of the diversity of having, you know, this modern family today is that, you know, it's changed our roles for the better. It's actually created a place where parents both, you know, have a role in raising and nurturing the kids. And I think what that's going to create is really a happy, well-rounded, balanced generation, a hope for our next generation. And, you know, I can't say enough about, you know, being inclusive and, you know, creating policy to support all the families and represent all the families out there, because I think that's going to be our next big step, and that's important. Laws are changing, you know, people's minds are changing. The modern family is becoming the majority in this country, and we've got to fall in step with that. You know, we've got to support those modern families, us being one of them. So I think this is what's going to create a lively discussion tonight on this panel. I think this is really, I think that my family, along with so many others, represents this new modern American family and this new modern family. And I think it's going to really just create, again, more openness, more awareness and in our society, which is, I think, what we all want. I think all of us here want that. So I'm happy with the fact that, you know, diverse families are now being super supported in this country, and that, again, minds are changing. People are becoming more open throughout, not even the United States, but out throughout the world. And that's something that I didn't know if I would see in my lifetime, to be honest with you, at one point. I really didn't. I didn't know in my lifetime at one point if I was going to be able to have to marry the person that I love, if I was going to be able to have children and have a family that I always dreamed of. But that's possible for anybody now, and that's a beautiful thing. So I'm excited to be on this panel. I'm excited to be with these brilliant people and sitting next to them and talking about the new American family. So thank you.
You know where you are.
I'm next to you, so I'm going to let you.
I'm the farthest from the podium.
Okay, good.
Hi, thank you all so much for coming. That was a great talk.
Thank you
so much, Kat. I have you prompted an anecdote, a memory of mine that I'll get to later, but I want to introduce everybody. So beside Kat, we have Frederick Goodall. He is a writer, a speaker, and a father. In 2008, he started the popular fatherhood blog Mocha Dad to chronicle his life as a dad and to counter the negative stereotypes regarding black fatherhood. He wanted to give readers a firsthand account of a black father who is intimately involved in his children's lives. Now he uses the blog to not only capture his experiences, but also to help motivate other men to be more actively engaged and involved with their children, families, and communities. And beside Frederick, we have Sarah Bowen. She is an associate professor at North Carolina State University. Her areas of specialization are the sociology of food, globalization, international political economy, and the sociology of community, numerous other areas as well. And she and colleagues have conducted a really fascinating study that I'm actually going to ask you to talk about in just a second. And beside Sarah is Latifa Lyles. She is the director of the Women's Bureau at the U.S. Department of Labor. We were just talking in the green room before this that the Women's Bureau at the Labor Department is 94 years old this year. It was founded in 1920, what did you say, two months before women got the vote, and has been tracking women's labor force participation and producing all sorts of data and studies and programs since then. So we're really thrilled to have everybody here talking about the modern family, and I don't know if we'll come up with the sorts of policies that we need tonight to support the family in all its forms, but we'll have a great conversation, and we'll try to at least get there a little bit. I have to say, your anecdote about your household just made me think of a conversation. I'm in a incidentally, I'm Liza Mundy. I'm the director of the Breadwinning and Caregiving Program at New America, and we call it the Breadwinning and Caregiving Program because we want to just promote the conversation and promote the notion and the reality that men and women alike are breadwinners and caregivers now, and we need to recognize that, and we need to move forward into a world through policy and conversation in which both men and women can fulfill those two crucial human functions. Anyway, your anecdote reminded me of a conversation I had. I'm the cook in my house. Mm-hmm. I have a son and a daughter. My son also cooks. He learned how to separate eggs at a very young age, which actually, kids really enjoy trying to learn how to separate eggs. My husband and my daughter really like to watch reality cooking shows. So we'll be sitting there cooking, and they'll be like, cheering on whatever works. But I remember having a conversation with a longtime friend of mine who is a who is in a longtime same-sex relationship, and we're both the cooks in our households, and we were talking about how we divide up and who does what, and he was saying although he cooks, he also likes to completely run his kitchen. He likes to clean. He likes to put everything away. He doesn't really let his partner in the kitchen because he likes to have everything just so. And I was saying, you know, because of sort of history, I really like my husband to clean after I cook because otherwise I feel like I'm doing all the housework and burdened, et cetera, et cetera. And my friend looked at me and he said, it must be exhausting to carry around all that ideological baggage. And I thought, and he said it in the nicest way. It was like, it was all new to him. I thought, yes, actually, that is exhausting. But anyway, every household has its trials.
And it has its cooks and its cleaners.
It's cooks and its cleaners.
I mean,
that's right.
I like that part. I like that, too. I mean, if I cook, I like my wife to clean and vice versa. And
right.
I know it's my task that if she cooks, it's my task to clean. And
right.
So, you know, I think that my dad always, he loved doing the dishes. I mean, he would, my mom would cook a great meal and he would sit there on a stool and just do the dishes. And, it, you know, that's just, it's, you know, so it's not so ideological.
No, it actually works.
This
was sort of a new idea to him.
Yeah.
I had to explain to him that historically women had been perfect those things. We were talking a little bit in the green room about, you know, all the conversation around food and nutrition and eating healthy that we've been hearing in the past, you know, particularly I'd say the past 5 or 6 years, thanks in part to the First Lady and her push to eat healthy, the garden. I hope you'll tell your garden anecdote at some point, your White House garden anecdote. And what's so interesting to me, I wanted to ask you, Sarah Bowen, to talk about your study, is that all of America has gotten this message. I mean, the message that it's important to get together for the family meal, people want to get together for the family meal. It's not actually that Americans don't know how to cook or that we're eating fast food all the time. But that sort of creates new hardships, actually, on working parents. And I wondered if you could talk about your really interesting study, maybe what prompted it and what you all found.
Yeah, so it's part of a bigger study about just how people feed their families and the challenges that go into that. And the main part of it is that we're doing interviews over a 5-year period with 120 low-income mothers in North Carolina. And then we combined that with one of our colleagues who did an additional set of interviews with middle-class mothers. And so we're having conversations with them about all of the things that affect how they feed their kids, and they all have young children. And one thing that surprised us a little bit, because we hear all this thing about how no one is cooking anymore, and to some degree, we have cut our cooking and cleaning time overall since the 60s, but they were cooking. They were cooking 4 or 5 nights a week, but especially the middle-class mothers, they were hearing all these messages that it has to be from scratch, it needs to be this way, and they felt like they weren't measuring up. And then for the poor and working-class families, they were cooking a lot, in part because it's the cheapest thing to do. But they weren't really, they didn't have any chance of meeting these ideals because of money and because of time and work schedules and all these factors. So,
So I just thought it was so interesting that you found that everybody is trying. Everybody at every income level in every kind of family has gotten the message that, you know, for our psychological health of our kids, for the health of our family, we need to try to draw together for these mealtimes. And it is incredibly difficult for families at every level.
Yeah, and people talked about how, in theory, they like to cook. They like to show how they care for their families, and this is a way to express creativity, and they liked having big family meals. They remembered those family meals. But as anyone that cooks on a daily basis, maybe even chefs, I don't know, knows, day in and day out, and especially when you have all of these financial and time pressures and things, it is really hard work. And there's a lot of things that complicate it.
And I should say that this is a conversation between, so anybody who wants to jump in at any point, don't wait for me to call on you.
Well, I mean, I can relate to that. I mean, I think even as a chef, and I mean, I can whip food up pretty quick and make something out of a lot of just pieces of things or leftovers or whatever, or you know, I mean, it is. I mean, I always have in the back of my mind because, you know, even though I'm a chef and I have that training, I'm a mom at heart, you know, so I walk in the kitchen and I want to make the best. I'm always thinking, is this good enough for the kids? Are they going to, I mean, is it healthy enough? Is it this enough? And is it, you know, so I'm doing the same thing. So I can imagine not having my, even with people that, you know, may not be, definitely don't have my skill level, which is probably, I mean, that's what I'm trained as, you know. I mean, a lot of people out in America aren't chefs. I mean, they're just learning from what they're learning from how they learn from their mom.
They're learning from you.
They're learning or learning from TV or shows, right? And so they're just trying their best. So I can imagine that stress level for them trying to measure up or feel like they need to measure up, because I'm feeling that same pressure. Maybe not to that extent, but I'm still feeling a pressure to measure up as a mom. You know, I mean, my gosh, when you start thinking about, like, I've got to take treats and snacks to soccer. I've got to be the soccer mom that's taking the treats. I'm
the
like,
the
okay.
The pressure on you, God. To be the
you know, yeah, they probably go, well, I could do orange wedges. Right. You know, I could do Capri Suns and orange wedges and, like, you know, whatever. So, I mean, they're probably expecting me, I don't know, maybe they're expecting me to bring a big cheese platter
I'm
or something.
I'm sure they are. I would be.
The kids are like, what? You know, this is about us. No, it's really not. It's really about, you know, got a reputation to protect. No. But I mean, I take like orange wedges or like chopped, like diced up watermelon and boxes, like fruit and this and that. But, you know, so I'm not making, but there's that pressure. Yep. You know, there's that pressure to do a really good job at whatever you're doing.
Well, I always have to tell my wife, please do not look at Pinterest. No, do that, because you can't do that. That's just not your skill. Don't let that make you feel bad about yourself or anything. You're
yeah,
a great
exactly.
mom. Just
that's
stay away
message.
From it. Just think of it as fantasy land. But you know, a lot of people going onto those websites and even at my kid's school, I go there and volunteer, and you know, they bring the cupcakes or whatever they bring, and there are these, oh my gosh, there are these big elaborate productions. Like, how do you even have time to do that? And then all the other parents are looking around with their like store bought kind of thing, kind of pushing them to the side. It can't compare to that, but there is so much pressure with parents, and sometimes it feels like a competition that you have to be the best parenting, and you have to, you know, do all these things that are just so amazing and incredible. But setting that bar that high just sets us up for failure and disappointment. We have to do things that are right for our family, that works for us within our frame of reference, and not allow those other things to try and push us out of our zone and try to do things that really aren't us.
Do you feel like you're less susceptible to Pinterest and to sort of the pressure to be perfect, you know, to put a perfect meal on the table? Do you feel like your wife sort of feels that more acutely?
Well, in our family, it kind of worked out a bit strangely, because when we first got married, I was the full-time cook, because I grew up learning how to cook. I grew up with a single mom, and essentially I had to learn how to cook if I wanted to eat, because my mom worked, plus she was going to school at night, so I had to try and get something on the table for my sister and me. So I learned how to cook. I had these skills. I actually enjoy it. But my wife, on the other hand, she actually grew up in a family with both parents. Her mom had the traditional role of caretaker and homemaker. But when her mom cooked, she was pretty much a perfectionist. So when my wife had to help her, you know, she never did it up to her mother's expectations. So her mother just took it over. So she got very frustrated with cooking and didn't like it at all. So, you know, we've been married for 17 years now. So over the years, she started to get into cooking, and now we kind of alternate back and forth in the cooking. But, you know, for dads, a lot of the times the bar is set very low for dads any type of caretaking.
Right.
you know, people look, I can go into the store with my kids and people will say, well, you're a great dad. Like, I'm a great dad for going shopping? Are you serious? The bar has to be set higher than that, but you know, it is so low. They don't expect men to be involved to do these things and to help their family in these ways. And things are changing, and I'm glad to see that. A lot more dads are getting much more involved, and that's what I encourage with men and with fathers. But you know, there's still that pressure, you know, to be the good father, to do the right things, and to make sure that my kids have the appropriate role model, because it's not something that I've ever seen, and you know, something that I promote, and that's something that I want to make sure that guys do, but they don't feel the pressure to that they have to be perfect, because none of us are perfect.
I want to just go back to the conversation about time. So, and I'm so glad that you said that. You know, today I think a fifth of families have the structure of one parent staying home. I mean, it's just not a reality anymore. And what that means is that families have less time because there's so much more time in the workplace, and we can't afford to not be working across the board. And related to food, personally, you know, again, when I was before I had my daughter, I used to enjoy the farmer's market and the fresh herbs. I had my own garden and all of these things. And I realized after a time that it was more about time, and it's much more meaningful to make a PB&J sandwich with my daughter, or to, you know, make a pizza, than it is to throw together some elaborate meal when I'm like super focused and I can't talk to anyone and no one's allowed in the kitchen. So in some way, I think because time is so valuable, how we spend that time is more critical than anything else. And you find that in all of these studies about outcomes for children and why reading is such a big deal is because your children are hearing your voice. And I think that when we get into being the perfect homemaker, we kind of lose ourselves. It's like, you know, the best host is mingling with her guests. And so think about it the same way. You know, are you sharing time with your family, or are you just trying to get it right? And I think the model of trying to get it right really does have to change, because we're plugged in, we're half checking emails, half, you know, cooking at the same time, and our attention really isn't there. And I think that that's going to be the challenge. It's quality. It's what we're doing in that period of time, which is going to be so important. And obviously, this discussion of dads is super critical. The White House did a summit on working families this June, and one of the president's quotes I remember, he was saying, you know, it's really time that we really in the workplace give women a fair shot and stop penalizing women for trying to be good parents, and then making such a big deal in some ways about a dad. And he said, you know, he's heard this before in his life, where it's a woman is thinking about taking some time off because she's a new mom. And I think he said the partners say, well, is she really committed? And the dad says, oh, I'm going to take a 2 weeks or 3 weeks off to spend time with my child. And he said, you know, the response is, aww. And it's this idea that there's this very bizarre double standard, and that, you know, you have an expectation to be perfect, but in a lot of workplaces, you're penalized for it. It's a note against you, and there's a lot of data that bears that out.
For women,
and there's this sort of inching up of cases related to caregiving responsibility and what that even, caregiving discrimination, excuse me, and what that even means. And that's one of the things that we're studying right now and talking about, because even for progressive workplaces, there's this implicit and understated, in some cases, bias where, you know, you think you're doing absolutely everything right and you make a decision that's mostly related to your family caregiving, and you come back and you are not on a track to partner, you are not given the promotion, you might be passed over, or your connection to the office or the company may be devalued because you had to take care of not just yourself, but maybe even a parent in some cases, which we also know is a major piece of the new modern family. It's also taking care of our parents in addition to our children.
Well, part of the issue too is we're one of only three countries that doesn't have mandatory maternity leave and family
leave.
Medical leave,
yeah.
And paid leave.
Right.
And the other two are Swaziland and New Guinea.
Right.
I mean, in the United States. The only countries that don't have mandatory maternity leave and pay for families. And, you know, I think that that's ludicrous.
Yeah, it's
unbelievable.
Yeah.
And the fact that there's no guarantee for a woman, like you were saying, you come back to your job after maternity leave because it's necessary for you to take care of your child. And you may not even have your job when you come back. And there's no protection for that for women and families as a whole.
Mm-hmm. You know, when I worked at my company, I worked there for 20 years. You know, when I had my first child, I went and talked to the HR person about paternity leave. I essentially was laughed out of his office. Like, are you kidding me? Get out of here. I don't even know what you're talking about.
And I'm sorry, yeah. When was this? How long ago was this?
Oh, I quit the company in 2012.
So not that long ago.
Right.
Yeah.
But when I asked for for my first child, time off, and you said people say, aw. They didn't say, aw. My boss actually said to me, what do you need to go to the hospital for? She's doing all the work.
Wow, God. Wow.
Really? Wow.
Wow.
When I had my third child, I was in the delivery room. My boss told me, make sure you keep your BlackBerry with you. He called me while I was in the delivery room with some nonsensical thing that he could have handled. But he kept talking to me like, I'm kind of busy right now. Can't call you back. But he kept on like, listen, this is ridiculous. I can't even enjoy the birth of my child without you calling me. But, you know, it's difficult for everybody in the workplace. I mean, men and women, I mean, just the whole notion of paid leave is something that we struggle with mightily here in the United States, and it really needs to change.
And there's a lot of, the White House Council on Economic Advisors came out with a couple of reports that are very relevant. One was on labor force participation. And while, women's labor force participation is higher than it has ever been, it stagnated, and we see pockets and segments or cohorts of working women who are not coming back, where we're not growing. And in fact, the discussion of many international labor conversations, including the most recent G20 summit in Australia, where our secretary was participating, was one of the major pieces of the conversation was how we can make sure we can ensure women's labor force participation. There's a lot of discussion about how we make up half the workforce. But the truth is, there are a lot of women who are dropping out. There are a lot of women who are either not fully employed, they're underemployed, they're working part-time, but they would like to work full-time and have a full career, or they don't have paid leave, or they don't have childcare, which is an even stronger indicator. And we know that's a major problem. And so across the world, not just here, countries are trying to figure out how to fix that. And you see some countries, Japan in particular, which is not necessarily, a bastion of feminist ideology, you would say, has figured out that it's an economic imperative to ensure that women can fully participate in their economy. And that means broader childcare provisions, and they want people to have kids. But they realize people aren't having kids and women are not coming in. And there are real dollars and cents to GDP, to even businesses' bottom line when you really have a talented, overeducated in some areas workforce who's not able to fully participate because they are doing something that most of us in our lives will experience, which is try to raise a family.
So I think one thing that we've identified is the change in policy that's happened is the policy attention to nutrition and the importance of meals and the importance of eating well, but there has not been any corresponding policy change either in terms of provision of childcare or paid leave that would actually enable people to do what they want to do, which is have this time to actually cook the meals that they'd like to cook and spend the time with the people they'd like to spend it with. Now, in your paper, Sarah Bowen, you all talk about some policy changes that might make life easier on working parents. Would you want to talk about any of them?
Well, one thing I was thinking about with some of these comments is that there are all these problems with leave and with work schedules, and of course, it's worse for poor families. And a lot of the jobs that we've gotten back since the recession have been these low-paying service jobs. A lot of the people that we interviewed worked in those. And so in those cases, it's an issue of time, but it's also an issue of schedule, and they don't have a lot of control over their schedule. They were finding out every week, like if they're working in a fast food restaurant, where they're going to go, and then they wouldn't have reliable child care, so they'd scramble to figure it out.
Or they paid for it, and they don't need it.
Right.
And it just made it impossible for those families. Like some of them would say, if I got home at 6 o'clock, like maybe I could do this, but right. We're getting home at 8 and 9 o'clock, and then having to try to get the kids to bed and just scrambling to try to just do it. And so one of the things we talked about was if this is important, that we need to figure out what we need to do to make it possible for all families and not just the relatively wealthy ones. And it's hard for them too in terms of work schedules and wages, the minimum wage. I think those are important things. And food access, more food policies too, but also policies that are more generally related to labor and work and wages. Mm-hmm.
She talked about the schedule. I know that's one thing many people struggle with. I know there was a point for me when I was pretty dedicated to having dinner at 6:30 every night. And I would struggle to get it at 6:30 every night. And it would stress me out so badly. And then one day, one friend said to me, "Why don't you just have dinner later?" Like, wow, I can do that. You know, so if I have dinner at 8 o'clock or 7:30, it's no big deal now. But it was just this incredible pressure that I was putting on myself, and I don't know why I was doing it to myself, but it was just something like, this is dinner time. Dinner has to happen right now. But it's just been liberating to kind of free myself. Hey, I can have dinner whenever I want to.
Except we were talking before the panel about the importance of sleep, right? So we know the importance of food. We know the importance of sleep. And you were saying that you managed to get four boys to bed.
Well, my wife and I managed. Okay. Not me alone. Let me specify that.
By 7:30.
By 7:30. We do. We have a pretty strict. Now, I mean, obviously, we get them in bed. They chat a little bit. But, I mean, I think that it is important, I mean, for kids in general, that especially in this day and age when our lives are moving faster. I was just saying this when I was speaking, our lives are moving faster than they've ever moved before right now, because of the, you know, technology highway, because of all of, you know, and the pressures that kids have. I mean, there's more homework than I've ever seen in kindergarten now. Our kids are bringing home folders of five-year-olds, you know, of homework. Starting at a really young age, there's, you know, the pressure to do extracurricular activities to keep them busy and keep them involved and socializing and socialized and things like that and active. There's pressures on parents across the board. And I'll have to say, you know, I agree with you that, you know, I'm not sure, you know, on all of the panel, but I know that for us, I mean, we are anomaly. I mean, we do have the ability and capabilities to put dinner on the table earlier. It's not lost on me that we're very blessed, like our family is, you know, that we can put the dinner on the table earlier because we're not working a job where someone else is controlling our schedule. We don't have the funds. We don't have this. So, you know, I'm speaking from a place of not being in that position, and my heart goes out to those families because I deal a lot with that with my charity. You know, hunger and nutritional education and hunger around the globe. But so I see that a lot. We do our best to get them on a schedule and keep them. I think the most important thing is whether they go to bed at 7:30, 8:30. It's consistent. I think kids need consistency and structure. And that's something we found with our four boys, because we could do a whole research on just four kids. I mean, like, we have enough kids. We have almost a soccer team. So, like, but we found that the consistency is more important. And then we were saying is that, you know, it's really about, and what you were saying earlier as well, is that it's really the quality that you're giving to the kids. Whether you're making a PB&J, whether you're making a roasted chicken, whatever you're doing, it's the quality that we're finding in research that's going to be most effective for our next generation, for our kids. It's the quality of time spent. It's the nurturing spent with our kids and those quality moments and that kind of time. Our kids don't care. I mean, they just want to see you. They want to hear your voice. They want to be told they're loved. They want to be, you know, fed and nurtured, and that's what they want. I mean, and structure. And I think that's, you know, it's very simplistic. You know, we I think our society and our world, we just tend to make it very, very complicated, but it's very simple. You know, I know that I didn't grow up with a lot of money in my family. We grew up, you know, low income, but we had lots of love. And it goes a long way in that nurturing and that quality time. So.
Yeah, it's just, as you said, Latifa.
It's trying to find that time.
Yes, and it's trying to think, what do I do in this little narrow window of time that I have? Would it be the cooking? Would it be the reading?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and it's compounded. I mean, you know, I completely agree with you that when you don't even have predictability about your schedule, you're not even sure when the time is going to occur.
Right.
And we know that in addition to, you know, raising the wages of so many of these women, many of whom are single parents, and, you know, this summer I had the opportunity to travel across the country and hear from women leading up to the White House summit. And it was remarkable to me that the most of the comments and the difficulty across income spectrums and, you know, the types of job was, were simple. They were childcare and my ability to connect with my children and know that they, having them know that I'm there and I'm working really hard, even if I don't see them at night. And, you know, the childcare piece of it is super important. It also, you know, intersects with nutrition as well. But, you know, it's this idea that there's a well-being. You know, we feel good, we're confident, we can work if we know our children are fed, taken care of, rested, healthy. And that gives us, you know, the opportunity to be better contributors to society ultimately. And our struggle with, you know, and one of the things about single moms, which we are learning more and more and more, is that it's the likelihood of a mother working is much higher if she's single, not, you know, and it's just across the board. And we know that it's not the case that you have very few people, you mentioned divorce rates and other things earlier today, where you have a lot of change in structure of the home. And around scheduling, there have been some studies about sort of how kids fare with the changing relationships with their family and their home structure, whether they're changing because of relationships, whether they're changing because you've moved a few times, whether you're changed because your parents' schedule is different. But there's a lot of uncertainty and there's a lot of unpredictability that does ultimately affect kids' livelihood. And it comes from knowing what you're going to eat and when to knowing where you're going to see your parents and where you're going to sleep, you know, in some cases.
Did you, when you decided to be a stay-at-home blogger, work at home, was that because of the lack of support you were getting from your company in terms of wanting to be an engaged dad or even be there when your child was born?
Well, when I worked for that company, I pretty much had to travel all the time. Mm. It got so bad that I could be in my office one day and my boss could come to me and say, tomorrow I need you to be in Iraq. So go home, get your stuff packed, get ready to go. It was just like that. So I had to call my wife, I have to go, I gotta go do this. So I was constantly on the road, you know, and then, you know, Kat, you mentioned it in your talks, you know, being on the road that much and coming back home, and there, my wife has established her schedule, right. You know, and I come and disrupt everything, right. and everything's all messed up for her. But that was a big part of it. But another part of it that really motivated me to do something differently is I was sitting in one of our executives' office, and he was talking to me, you know, we want you to be an executive at this company. And he started going through this litany of things, like, and you're going to have to make these sacrifices. You're going to have to do this thing. And when we tell you to do this, you're going to have to do this and this and this. And it was like I was having an out-of-body experience. like, I don't want to do any of that. I don't want to make any of those sacrifices at all. Because really, for me, the price was too high because I knew that I wouldn't have the time to engage with my family and be there for my kids. I knew I'd constantly be on the road. I knew I'd be in the office till 11 o'clock at night. And I simply did not want to do that. So it was about 6 months later that I turned in my resignation and decided to start my own company and do things for myself.
So it was your company was asking, and the complete did they try to entice you to stay saying, oh, you?
Well, they didn't. They tried to entice me to stay with money.
Right, with money. But, so it's that like that line from Mad Men. That's what the money is for.
But you know, money wasn't the thing.
Right.
So I mean, they didn't really get it. What it was really the crux of the matter. So I worked in an industry, and I'll admit, I worked in the construction industry, so, you know, they're still a bit behind in a lot of things, because there's a lot of macho attitudes within that industry. So it was a bit difficult, but I just did not want to do the things they wanted me to do. I believed that my family was more important. I believed that doing other things, that things I'm doing now are more important than what I was doing there, so... It was an easy decision for me, really.
It's just interesting to hear you say that because, you know, there's a fair amount of talk now about paternity leave and dads getting more engaged and companies, you know, particularly in Silicon Valley, offering really good paid leave for mothers and fathers. And I was talking to a woman who works in human resources at Twitter saying that the difficulty is actually getting men to take it. They offer it, but they can't get the men to take it.
Well, a lot of the guys don't take it because there is that pressure that they feel as if they aren't committed. Like, hey, man, really, you're going to take 2 weeks off. We need you. You need to be here. I mean, it's just what you talked about. Women feel that, men feel that same pressure too. Like, if you're not here being committed to the job, you know, we can get someone else. And guys feel that pressure. Like, if I don't do it, they'll get somebody else. They'll fire me. Right. I won't be able to take care of my family. So that's one of the big reasons why men don't take it. I know a lot of guys who have had it at their companies, they don't take it because they don't want to be seen as a slacker.
Right. You know, some of the policies, you know, it's rare in this country to have programs of your company offers it, but it's not a federal mandate, obviously. But in some areas like California, for instance, where there has been a paid leave program for 10 years, there's now data that shows what the uptake is. And it's very interesting if you look at the California data that actually shows the increased rates of men taking leave for caregiving of their children. And I think the more we highlight the fact that it is actually a need and actually can be a norm, I think that it sort of demystifies it a little bit. And the stigma really just is just palpable. I mean, you talk about this idea that people don't take it, even if it's there. In other countries, it's required. Maternity and paternity in some countries, you have to take it, I understand. And so this idea that it's actually a mandate because it's a good idea, it's good for you and it's good for your child. We're not seeing that at all here.
You know, when I left my company, I had 500 hours of unused vacation time. Because there is just this pressure, like, you just don't take a day off. You come to work, and that's what you do. and I was thinking about this when I quit, like, 500 hours?
Yeah, that would
that's
be
a lot of time.
That would be an interesting study. How many unused
right,
hours
definitely.
Of vacation exist? Right. It's like a kind of time that
yes.
should exist but doesn't exist. Yeah. And incidentally, for people who know, the California model that you're talking about is that California has had 6 weeks guaranteed paid leave for caregiving of children or parents, and it's paid for by a small contribution from people's payroll tax, so businesses don't have to pay it. And the studies do show that in terms of getting men to take it, having it be paid makes a big difference
yes.
because of the care of the breadwinning mm-hmm. responsibility and having it available. Also, I mean, they have seen a steady uptick in both men and women taking leave, and businesses have not suffered the way that businesses said they would 10 years ago when they started it. But that's been a really, I think, what it's four states now that
three.
Have that. Yeah, three.
But
and one that has it but hasn't figured out
hasn't
how to pay
has,
for it.
Right, has it right. Washington. So, and we actually just last month, we announced grants to three states to do additional analysis of programs. And we know that there are a lot of efforts on the ground to continue to at least do this at the state level, knowing that we don't have a federal program.
Right.
And what we're finding, as you pointed out, which is a big part of the discussion this summer, was the business community coming forward as well to say, not only do I have maternity and paternity, but my employees use it. And the business community partnership with these policy efforts is so incredibly important. And we see, you mentioned Twitter, I think, there are a lot of companies who are really happy to come forward and talk about their practices and why it works for them. Companies that are profitable, popular, and have a diverse workforce. And I think that's another key to this conversation is that, you know, many of these sensible policies, and it's also the same with minimum wage increases across the country, we know that the business community is behind them and they know that their workers need this, and it's an imperative for them ultimately if they want to attract and retain the best talent.
Although, again, your experience just really makes me question to what extent the business community really is behind it. I mean, some are.
Certainly. I think it's our job to find, I think it's our job to highlight where those wins are and to highlight where those best practices are, because we live in a very competitive economy.
Right.
And
right.
part of our job is to create a space where folks can come together and say, look, right. I did this. I'm a leader in my industry. You
right.
can do it too.
But it can create the illusion also that business in general is on board with this. I mean, I think it's also really, really important to hear these case studies as well, to be reminded.
And the people who work at these companies will eventually move on to these other companies that offer these benefits, and the companies will be forced to change or else they'll lose all the talent.
If we made it mandatory, then that would take care
right.
of all
right.
the issues.
Right. I have to say.
Let's just make it mandatory like everybody else in the world.
Yeah.
And that way, no one has to worry about anything.
Right.
The businesses
right.
or the business people, because it becomes a law.
Right.
It becomes a policy.
Right.
That no one has to worry about it.
I had that same thought. I mean, just in my driveway this week, I was talking to my next door neighbor who just had a little baby, and it was a little baby. I mean, you know, born like six pounds, and she's a lawyer with a suburban firm, and her husband is too. And she went back at 6 weeks, and in fact, she had a trial, and so she had to sort of go back and do some work at 5 weeks. And it didn't sound like her husband was getting any paternity leave at all. And I saw them holding this little. I mean, the baby now weighs maybe 9 pounds, and the baby care is in daycare. You know, and daycare, that's great. I mean, daycare is great, but not at that age. And I had that same thought. You know, if two lawyers working for law firms in the D.C. area, if that's all she gets, then it's
make
just
it affordable
have,
for people
just
who own their own businesses, like myself, own their own businesses. I had a baby. My wife had our first three, and I had our last. We were actually pregnant for 6 months together, but that's a whole nother panel. A whole nother panel discussion. But we were pregnant together for 6 months, and I had a baby, and I had, because I was a sole breadwinner, and I had a hard pregnancy, so I had a hard labor, I should say, and now our littlest guy who I had was in the NICU for 10 days, and I mean, I'm a freelance, I have my company, it's all freelance, and so... and I had to go back to work being the sole breadwinner after 4 weeks. I mean, so we had to get him out of the NICU, get him, and then we had two babies. So it's the pressure is not only for people who have bosses, but who are bosses and have small companies and small businesses.
Right.
And we need more policy for small business owners as well around these things.
Yeah. That's a remarkable anecdote as well. I feel like I should open it up to questions. It's a little hard for us to see, but I might take some questions from Twitter. Also, the only rule of the questions is that at some point the answer has to have to do with the White House garden.
Okay.
So if that
I'll just
has
tell
to
that
happen,
story. It has
you
to
just
happen,
have to
I'll
make that
happen.
The answer.
I will.
Okay. We have a question.
Hello.
Hi.
My question goes back to nutrition. I am a mother of an 11-month-old, and I'm in academia, and it was also very challenging. People said, oh, academia is supposed to be easier. You know, you can kind of take your time, and I found it very challenging, and it goes back to the nutrition thing with breastfeeding. And I found that to be very challenging among friends of mine who were like, you want to breastfeed? Do you know what that's going to do to your body? How are you going to get that support? But I had a very hard time in academia having the conversation with them about, I need a place to pump. And this is important for the nutrition of my child. So I wanted to see what your insights are there. And just one other thing was going back to husbands and kind of having that conversation with my husband about, I cannot do this alone. I didn't get here alone. You were with me when we made this child. And you will be with me to do everything else. But also making that ask of him because he was used to very traditional roles. So how... any conversation that you can offer on, you know, making that ask. For me, it was very challenging, but once I did, he really stepped up to the plate and actually wanted to.
So I'll just quickly, and on nursing mothers, I have a funny story about having jury duty when I was nursing, and I was working, and I went in, and I told the judge very sternly, I'm nursing, and she goes, well, take breaks. So I carted my supplies with me every day to jury duty. I was selected. It was a 5-day trial. And had to put my stuff through the machine, and I'll never forget the face of the security guard as my stuff was going through, and he says, is this your bag, ma'am? And I said, yes, it is my bag, and as he's pulling it over, and he's starting to unzip it, I'm like, it's a breast pump. Okay, you go right ahead. So if you ever want to sneak something into the D.C. court, just tell him you're carrying a breast pump.
Everybody's tweeting that now, you know.
So one of the things that we did at the Department of Labor, and this administration in the last couple of years was to clarify that folks break a rule under the wage and hour division that required companies within a certain parameters. I'm not sure if your particular employer would be in this category, but the idea is that you allow nurse time, break time for nursing mothers, which also includes space. You have to have a locked door. It cannot be a bathroom. And part of what we're doing too is to help educate employers and people about what this is and what this means. I was talking to a local union representative from the Washington Metro, and she was saying how when the rule first came out, there was a lot of questions. What does this mean? How do we do it? And she told me the story of there was a woman who was a bus engineer, and she her job mostly was fixing the buses as they came through the station. And she said, you know, in that case, there were a lot of questions, but we ultimately figured it out. She was nursing, she needed to pump, and we figured out a place for her, but there was a lot of confusion in the beginning. And I think even having these conversations and talking about these issues is super important. But there are protections, depending on where you are and the situation specifically, where now many employers are required to allow that protection in that space for you.
Did anybody want to respond to the making the ask part of the question, like why it's so hard to ask your partner to help, because it can be really hard.
Well, let me address that from my perspective, because actually a lot of women email me with this specific question, and it's something I had to learn from my own relationship with my wife. There are a lot of things that I guess I wasn't doing that she was very frustrated about, and she was just angry about it all the time, and I didn't know this. Because she never said anything about it until one day there we had a big argument. She let me know, hey, I want you to do this, this, and this. And then I just said, why didn't you ask me to? Like, well, you should know. Like, I need you to specifically say what it is you want me to do, because I have my own assumptions on what needs to get done. And a lot of guys are the same way. And, you know, spouses in general, you know, they have their own ways of doing things. They have their own way that they were brought up, or things that they believe in, ways that they do things. We have to be very open with these conversations and fully express clearly, I need you to do this because this will be very helpful to me. And like you said, when you said it that way to your husband, he did it. But sometimes we hold on to this anger and these things because we make these assumptions that really aren't true, and we really need to be more vocal about it. And that really helps in relationships and helps with the communication, because, you know, one partner is not just angry and just sitting there upset because something's not happening or someone's not meeting their needs or doing what they need them to do. We have to be more open and more honest and more forthcoming about what we need in a relationship, especially when there are children involved, because you know, I have three children, and they get me very stressed quite often. And I know my wife and I try and be a unified team with the kids, but we have to know what we need from each other to make sure that we can give our kids what they need.
And I think it's important to go with it. You know, I think there's still, even though I didn't grow up in a traditional home, I didn't have two parents, I still have these notions, and they're not even my experience, but I still have them, you know. And, you know, if something happened, God forbid, and my husband was gone for a period of time, I'm pretty sure I could figure out how to use the laundry machine. But I just don't go down to the basement. It's just not what I do. And, you know, there are days when, you know, I look inside and I'm like, you know, am I not setting the role model for my daughter because I fold my own laundry? And no, I don't really have that concern. But I think that there are these residual, it's just part of who we are, where we feel like we've got to live up to this paradigm. But I think that's part of the new American family is, you know, what does that even look like? And I think we're all creating it in this room.
More questions?
Hi, my name is Priya Kumar. A question when we were talking about kind of the mandatory paid leave, which I agree, it's a really important thing. But in a complicated political environment, how do you pitch or explain to either taxpayers or businesses that that is something they should fund?
Who wants to take that question?
Well, I mean, from the perspective of, you know,
everybody looks down there.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of different ways to go about it. I think that the key, going back to the point that I was making too, is having leadership in the communities and in the industries and workers and workplaces where you have industry leaders saying, this is a big deal, I can do this. And I know it varies if we're talking about a Google versus a small business, but I think that a big part of how we move in this country is through these little labs that we call like our communities and our states. And I think the more we can shine a light on what's happening at the local level where there are wins, and part of our job is to study those and to show how they are working, I think the better. I think there is in some area an imperative to be competitive. And I think that if we're creative in looking at those industries where we know we have labor shortages and we know we're trying to attract talent, what we can do creatively with those industry leaders to make the workplaces more amenable to working families, I think is one creative way that we could do that.
Sarah Bowen, when you were looking at families in North Carolina, I assume they were in North Carolina, did you see any I know you talk in your study about ways in which life could be made easier for the workers that you're studying. You talk about, you know, that community food banks could provide ready-made meals and that people could take home. Did you see anything bubbling up from the local level that would be a fix?
For food?
Well, to make people's lives easier, you're not going to be seeing paid leave initiatives bubbling up, but I'm thinking of other community or state initiatives.
Most of what we looked at was food, so I have more examples from food, and you do see interesting. You know, people are resilient and creative, and they come up with different things, and you see it at all levels. Like we heard about one group of moms that started cooking. They started like a frozen meal swap where they'd each cook five of the same one and then they'd all swap. So you get five meals and you only have to cook once. And that's like a really local level, like a neighborhood.
And were these low-income moms?
This example was middle-class moms. Mm-hmm. The low-income moms we interviewed also talked about just sharing cooking, like cooking together, cooking with friends and doing that as a way to share labor, but it's also fun and, you know. There's bigger level things, and including like the market has answers. Like, I can have my groceries delivered to my door now. I can have almost anything delivered to my door, and that helps.
By drones, eventually.
I know. but some of those fixes are not. They're not affordable for lots of families.
Right.
Like there's a lot of really good, healthy, prepared food mm-hmm. at a lot of grocery stores now, but not everyone can afford it. So we talked a little bit at the end about how we haven't figured this out, but maybe we should start talking about what are some more collective ways of thinking about this kind of work that could be more accessible to all families. Like, is there a way to use school kitchens for to-go meals that would be affordable that families could then heat up when they get home and they don't have any time? Or we have a grocers on wheels in Raleigh that he is continuing the legacy of his dad, and he's bringing produce to neighborhoods, and he's specifically focusing on food insecure neighborhoods and doing it in a way that works for those neighborhoods. He accepts food stamps, he takes credit, and so I think there are a lot of good ideas that are coming from all these different pockets, but we could also use some help from the federal and state level in terms of bigger scale things.
Right. I think the busing programs for, you know, sending, you know, fresh produce out to food deserts, you know, I know Illinois is doing a lot of those, and some other, you know, states and local cities have started, you know, having programs popping up like that, which I think are fantastic, because you don't have any access in food deserts and places that are food insecure to any kind of fresh produce or fresh food. One thing that my charity has done is Cher, who's on tour right now, is chosen my charity, Chefs for Humanity, as a go-to charity to do a mobile giving campaign throughout her tour. And what we've done is we've taken it and created a program with Wholesome Wave, and which is out of Baltimore. And what we're doing is we're doing a program called a double value coupon program. So anyone that's on food stamps or anybody participating in SNAP can go to their local farmers market, because there's many, many urban farmers markets and accessibility, and use their food stamps for a 2-for-1 fresh fruit and vegetable program. And then we're trying to expand that out to just regular grocery stores. I mean, affordable grocery stores. We're not talking about Whole Foods, and which that's a possibility, but mostly to the affordable grocery stores and grocers and the larger chains that are definitely much more affordable. So programs like that, I mean, if we can continue doing some of those through charities, but I agree with Sarah, is that we, you know, it would be programs that are, you know, funded by the federal government is also helpful.
More questions? I see one in the back.
Um, So what I'm kind of interested in is I hear about all of these great options for choice, and I'm curious about the dichotomy between supporting dads that are making choices to cut back and then in families where moms maybe are choosing to work part-time or half-time, or dads are choosing to work part-time or half-time, and then hearing things where we hear we don't want people to choose to stay home, or we don't want people to be not fully engaged in the workforce or contributing, and how we align giving people more options to work full-time if they want to with not condemning people that are making choices to spend more time with family, so that we're encouraging all of the choices instead of just some.
Did you have that directed at anybody in particular on the panel? Or no?
Well, you know, I will just start by saying I completely agree with you. I think at this part of the new American family is that we all have, you know, more choices than we ever have in the labor force and how we decide to raise our children and pursue careers. But I think that for so many people, you know, their choice is whether or not they work the extra shift or, you know, make it home for bedtime. And I think that there's this idea that within people's realities, there are some choices that are painful and they're hard. And, you know, what we can do to change the paradigm and the policies so that the folks that simply, you know, in some ways don't feel like they even have one can still make, you know, be a part and a present part of their family, which we think is also how you're successful. It's being successful at home and being successful in the workplace. And I think right now, so many people have to choose one or the other, or neither in some cases.
Right. What you want is people making choices in a landscape where they have real options.
That's
and
right.
Where they have
right.
support, so that they're not choosing to stay home because there's no child care or
right.
no affordable
right.
child care. They're choosing to stay home because that's what they prefer to do, but there is child care available if they, so it's a real choice.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, it sounds like you were in a situation where there was actually the choice was so clear because it wasn't a real.
Yeah, but I mean, but so many guys I know a lot of guys who ended up being stay-at-home dads because, you know, when the recession came, they were laid off. They couldn't
right.
find a job. I know a lot of guys who are like, you know, 50 and above. I just did a segment on my local TV station about this. There were so many guys who simply opted out. I'm not even going to try anymore. Like, there's no point. I can't get a job. So, you know, by default, he became a stay-at-home dad.
Right.
I don't know if that was a lot of those guys' initial choice. I mean, they've become comfortable with it, but for so many people, the choice was made for them,
right.
and they ended up having to live with the consequences. And you know, for some people, that worked out well. For some people, it doesn't work out so well. And like you said, being able to make that active choice is so important in people's lives because they feel as if they're in control and they have that sense of purpose and they feel as if this is something that I wanted to do. It's not something that was forced
right.
on me. And when you have those choices, I think you're better able to stand behind those choices and what you've decided to do.
Yeah, that's well put. I think we have time for one more question, but we already know what the answer is going to be. Ask a question, yeah, I tell that story.
You guys touched on this a little bit, but I'm hoping that you can talk about it just a little bit more. And this is for anybody who wants to weigh in. I'm thinking about, you mentioned like mainstreaming the realities of this modern family dynamic. And I'm wondering if you can talk about really the effects of social media shaming. And I do mean Pinterest, you know, making you feel like you're, you know, like how to get everything right. Facebook, you look at that and you think that all your friends are doing it right and you're doing it wrong, in perpetuating these myths and expectations, but also really the communities of support, the extent to which those are really encouraging the normalization of these modern family dynamics. Certainly what you're doing with Mocha Dad comes to mind as something that's helping people to kind of get to that.
Well, I was going to bring this up too, because it's so important today with social media and all online platforms. Now, I make my living online and, you know, I love online, but the internet makes me cry some days because just to see how people treat one another because they're been sitting behind a screen. You talked about the shaming. The food shaming is horrendous online. I can see someone send out a tweet, says, hey, you know, I'm so tired. All I have the energy for is to heat up a pizza for my kids. then all these people start attacking them. I can't believe you're feeding your kids that. I can't believe you're doing that. You're a terrible mom, blah, blah, blah. Like, oh my God, this is awful. like you have no idea what that person is going through and what their life is like. And you're in no position to judge what they're doing, but there's so much pressure on us to do the right things in people's minds and what we've been conditioned to believe is the right thing. And the online social media just amplifies it so much. It just builds up that stress. So I really think that you talked about the communities of support. When you can find those good communities of support, that's golden. Like-minded people who want to help you, who want to encourage you, to give you advice and show you different things, to different ways to do things, and some things that you may not have considered before. I mean, take advantage of any of those communities, not only online, but in the real world. When you have those support communities, it just makes everything better for you.
You know, I want to add to that. I think there are a couple things. I think we can change the conversation with social media. We have an unprecedented opportunity to be responsible and using social media to start changing the way we think about these things. We have a new campaign, Department of Labor, hashtag lead on leave, where we have a video that was our first viral video ever a couple weeks ago. And it's an animation, and it's two women who are pregnant. One is from the United States and one is in Germany. And obviously, you know how the story goes. But it was opened by, I think, over 4 million people. And we don't have that kind of viewership at all on most of the things that we do. And we just use that little small thing to start a conversation. But on the other hand, I think the community for women and working moms who get into, like, is this happening to me only? And honestly, from a personal perspective, it's even if it's like some random crazy person, if you read something that's like, well, yeah, that happened to me. Yes, my child woke up 5 times last night. Or yes, you know, this is how I'm feeling about this decision I made. And in some ways, I think, you know, there are some networks. We work with Moms Rising and other groups that are really starting to create spaces where you can at least see yourself online. Even if you don't participate, you can just, you know, read the scrolls until you're sick. But I think that is an area where a lot of working moms didn't have that network before. And so I think there's a way to feel part of something, even if you are just on the sidelines, to absorb that that conversation and see what's going on in other people's lives and knowing that you're not by yourself.
Well, I think that's all the time we have for questions, except I just wanted to say
she cannot stand it. I got to tell the story.
I understand that you've worked with the first lady on her nutrition program. And
yeah, so, well, I was cooking at the White House a couple of years ago, and it was for Greek Independence Day, because they always have a chef, and especially a Greek American like myself, who comes in and cooks for, you know, the Obamas and all of their guests. And so I'm cooking in the kitchen, and I said, you know, I really want to go out to the garden and get some herbs. And so the chef calls down to the snipers and says, or the security, and says, tell the snipers to stand down. We're going out to get herbs. So.
And they did it, and they
lived
to tell the
tale. And the fastest herbs I ever cut in my life.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for coming. Thank you so much to our panelists. You all were really wonderful, and it's a great conversation.
Yeah, thank you.
It was fun. Thank you for having us.